Carl Benz was born on the 25th of November, 1844 in Karlsruhe. He later attended the Polytechnic University there before gaining his first practical experiences at various mechanical engineering companies. He founded his own company in 1872, the Eisengießerei und Mechanische Werkstätte. However, it was not much of a success at first. It was only the dowry of Carl's wife, Bertha, that saved them from immediate ruin. In 1877, Benz started developing a two-stroke engine, and after 2 years, it ran sufficiently for the first time. The patent for a gas-fueled four-stroke cycle engine was already owned at that time by the Gasmotorenfabrik in Deutz. Nevertheless, Benz did patent some of his inventions, such as his engine speed regulator. A stock corporation under the name Gasmotorenfabrik Mannheim was set up in 1882. Carl Benz resigned from it a short time later, though. It was only the founding of the Benz & Company Rheinische Gasmotorenfabrik, together with the entrepreneurs Max Rose and Friedrich Wilhelm Esslinger, that led Benz to eventual success. The company, established in 1883, expanded quickly and was even able to grant licenses for the construction of gas-fueled engines. For Benz, it finally became possible to devote his time to the development of the car engine. Unlike Daimler, who integrated his engine into a carriage, Carl Benz was aiming for the development of an entire vehicle. In 1886, he was able to present his first Benz patent motor car to the public, a three-wheeled vehicle powered by a four-stroke gasoline engine. From 1885 to 87, three models with slight variations were produced. With the so-called Model 3, Bertha Benz undertook the first long-distance drive in the world in 1888. At a distance of 100 kilometers from Mannheim to Pforzheim, she experienced an adventurous drive. Without her husband, but with her sons. She only let him know after a happy arrival. In 1893, Carl Benz introduced axle pivot steering to car construction, followed 3 years later by the Contra engine, the ancestor of today's piston engine. The breakthrough for Benz & Company came in 1894 with the Velo. This light and budget-priced automobile was manufactured for 5 years. With a total production sum of about 1,200 units, it was the first mass-produced car in the history of the automobile. At the turn of the century, Benz & Company grew to be the leading manufacturer of automobiles in the world, with over 430 employees at the time. Carl Benz left the company 2 years later on account of discrepancies with the management. Together with his son Eugen, he established a new company in Ladenburg in 1906. Until the mid-20s, the Benz and Zerner cars were produced there. As taxis, they gained a certain degree of recognition, especially in England. As opposed to Gottlieb Daimler, who died 1900, it was granted to Carl Benz to witness the boom of motorization and the final breakthrough of his idea. Carl Benz, one of the fathers of the automobile, died in 1929 at his house in Ladenburg. Gottlieb Daimler was born on the 17th of March, 1834, in Schorndorf. From 1857 to 1859, the journeyman metalsmith attended the Polytechnic University in Stuttgart. Daimler became familiar with the four-stroke principle of the Automotor during his time with the Gasmotorenfabrik Deutz, where he was employed as head of engineering until mid-1882. With his generous compensation, he bought a villa in Cannstatt, where he set up an experimental workshop in the garden. Feverishly, he worked on the development of a gasoline-driven motor, which was supposed to run all vehicles imaginable, on land, on water, and in the air. The first experimental motor emerged in collaboration with Wilhelm Maybach, who Daimler had already met many years ago in Reutlingen. In 1884, an improved version, dubbed the grandfather clock on account of its look, achieved 1 horsepower at 600 rotations per minute, considerably more than all former gasoline motors. After his first experiments with a two-wheeler, Daimler ordered a carriage from Hamburg in 1886. Under Maybach's instruction, a 1.5 horsepower engine, modeled after the grandfather clock, was installed. Using belts to relay its drive power, it became the world's first four-wheeled automobile and was completed secretly overnight. Exhilarated by the success of his motorized carriage, Daimler rented premises for production. Under the technical direction of Wilhelm Maybach, he employed 23 workers. As a mere experimental workshop, the factory was not sustainable for long, although the parallel production of boat motors did make profits. His last hope was collaboration with the powder manufacturer Max Dudenhofer and his friend Wilhelm Lorenz, which culminated in the foundation of a stock corporation in 1890. The Daimler Motorengesellschaft offered Maybach a contract for the position of technical director, but he refused. The conditions did not meet his expectations. Without Maybach, and more than ever after the exclusion of Gottlieb Daimler, the technical progress of the company stagnated, along with it, its success. Meanwhile, Maybach's Phoenix motor was causing a stir abroad. A group of English industrialists wanted to purchase the licensing rights. All previous efforts to get Maybach back to Stuttgart were failing on his condition that Gottlieb Daimler return to the company as well. The management finally had to give in, and so both founding fathers were aboard once again. This new constellation brought the Daimler Motor Corporation in 1895 to an unimagined boom. Maybach committed everything to make the company competitive again with new technical developments. But his old friend Gottlieb Daimler died only 5 years later, on the 6th of March, 1900, just before the first Mercedes entered production. With the invention of a fast-running engine and the automobile, Gottlieb Daimler and Carl Benz laid the foundation stone for individual motor car traffic. Both brought their own developments into the company, and both were looking for a catchy and unmistakable brand name. And that was how, at the turn of the century, the Daimler Motor Corporation caused furor with a completely new brand name, Mercedes. This Spanish name first belonged to Mercedes Jelinek, the daughter of Austrian business tycoon Emil Jelinek. Her sport-crazed father was especially enthusiastic about the automobile, and he was convinced that it would change the future with lasting effect. Being the best, and at times the only major customer of the young Daimler Motorengesellschaft, he demanded faster and more powerful vehicles every other year, presenting continuous challenges for the chief engineer, Wilhelm Maybach, and at the same time pushing progress forward. From 1899 on, Jelinek entered his vehicles in races, especially in the Nice Speed Week. The driver and his team were registered under a pseudonym, the name of his 10-year-old daughter, Mercedes. A fatal accident occurred in 1900 at the La Turbie hill climb, so Jelinek pressed for the production of a vehicle both faster and more lightweight. The newly developed sports and racing car with 35 horsepower was the first one to bear the name Mercedes. With its low center of gravity, compressed steel frame and high-performance engine, it is regarded today as the first modern automobile. The Mercedes cars used at the Nice Week of 1901 turned out to be unbeatable in all categories. Vehicle and owner became the talk of the time. Paul Meillant, the Secretary General of the French Automobile Club, was deeply impressed by its success. In retrospect, he wrote of the race, "We were entering the era Mercedes." In March and April, the sister models 1216 horsepower and 811 horsepower were released. Jelinek's additional orders stretched the Cannstatt Daimler plant to full potential. On the 23rd of June in 1902, the name Mercedes was entered as a trade name, followed by legal registration on the 26th of September. Emil Jelinek obtained permission to call himself Jelinek Mercedes from then on, commenting, "Probably for the first time, a father bears the name of his daughter." After the merger of the former competitors Benz and Daimler in 1924, the product range was initially modernized. An attractive but above all affordable vehicle was a major goal for competitive car sales programs in the 20s, which were conditioned by crises. A special importance, therefore, lay in the development of a new 2-liter model. Since 1923, the direction of the Central Engineering Office had been in the hands of Ferdinand Porsche. One of his inventions was the new 2-liter model 838 horsepower. The first number stood for the cubic capacity related taxable horsepower. The second determined the actual engine performance. With the beginning of sales in autumn 1926, the startup model, internally called W02, was first available in three body variations: as open-top touring car and as saloon with either two or four doors. Model 838 was an immediate success. In 1927 alone, its production total was double that of all totals from the previous year by Mercedes, Benz, and Mercedes-Benz. In the course of changing type designation, 838 horsepower was renamed 838 Type 200 in February 1928. The improved model debuted in November 1928 at the Berlin Automobile Exhibition, where it caused quite a stir under the name Stuttgart 200. By the way, with certain extensions, the three figured numbers are still part of today's Mercedes-Benz nomenclature. The six-cylinder engine in the 828 had a high potential that parented numerous drive mechanisms over the next 12 years. One of those was the 1050 horsepower, type Stuttgart 260. Internally called W11, this new 2.6-liter car was supposed to close a gap in the sales program and thus meet demands for higher performance at the same price. All in all, 9,105 units of the 828 horsepower were produced. Type Stuttgart 200 was manufactured 6,452 times, and 6,757 units of the Stuttgart 260 were driven from the production plant. Numbers which proved the resounding success that the model ranges W02 and W11 had in their day. The Mercedes-Benz S-Types, internally known as W06, are counted among the outstanding sports cars of the Roaring Twenties. The S originally stood for sport and was followed by variations such as SS, meaning super sport, SSK, which denoted super sport version with short wheelbase, and SSKL, a lighter racing version of the former. Many of the wealthy gentleman owners drove their sporty Mercedes in both normal traffic and on the racetrack. with success. The first race, at the opening of the Nürburgring on June 19, 1927, ended with a triple victory of the S-Type. With the SSK, the well-known Rudolf Caracciola won the Klausenpassrennen in August 1930 and also became the European hill climbing champion. He had another outstanding triumph a year later with the lighter SSKL as the first foreign driver in the Mille Miglia, the still legendary 1,000-mile race in Italy. Incidentally, on account of their imposing appearance in the white racing paint, the S models were popularly known as white elephants. Not without reason. With an operational supercharger, the SSKL generated a stunning 300 horsepower and was able to reach what was for those days a breathtaking top speed, 235 kilometers per hour. While the design of the Type S emphasized suitability for racing, the SS was, from 1928, first and foremost, a Gran Turismo, which was underlined by the body-type options. The legendary SSK was a child of the mountains, because short and agile vehicles were clearly advantaged on alpine racetracks. The wheelbase of the S model was shortened to 2,950 millimeters in 1928. For daily use, some customers had a convertible top attached to the existing chassis. 33 of those sporty two-seaters were produced between 1928 and 1932. The fourth and last model of the S range was designed solely as a competition vehicle. The lightweight SSKL was not part of the official sales program. Although only a small number were produced, it was the culmination of the legendary S-Range that shaped the sporty image of the Mercedes-Benz brand. The last cornerstone of the newly fashioned Mercedes-Benz car program, under the direction of Ferdinand Porsche, was the Type Nürburgring 460. The name recalled a test drive on the Nürburgring, where a Type 460 was driven 20,000 kilometers in 13 days. This was the first mass-produced Mercedes with an 8-cylinder engine and premiered at the Paris Auto Show in October 1928. R15,000 was the handsome price of a Pullman limousine of the Nürburgring type, which was already being revised in its second year. The previous high-frame chassis was replaced by a low-frame, which gave the vehicle a more elegant appearance. Moreover, a variation with a shortened wheelbase was produced and designated with a K. This shorter chassis could accommodate a 4- to 5-seat passenger compartment. The regular Nürburgring 460 with a standard wheelbase was available as an open-top touring car or Pullman limousine, each sitting 6 to 7. From 1931 on, the Nürburgring 460 was optionally supplied with overdrive or economy drive for an extra 2,000 Reichmarks. The add-on charge also included Zeiss headlights. Together with its 5-liter engine, this marked the birth of the later type, Nürburgring 500. Visually, this model with its greater cubic capacity could not be differentiated from Model 460, the production of which was finally stopped in 1933. The successor was renamed Type 500, or 500N, and is recognizable by its slightly slanted windshield and V-shaped radiator. After a delivery total of 931 vehicles, the last 7 units of the Type 500 were produced in October 1939. Created for a circle of fortunate people who do not want to limit the fulfillment of their wishes. With this distinct advertising message of the early 30s, Mercedes-Benz targeted an elite clientele for the Type 770. The Grand Mercedes was literally a vehicle of superlatives. As the largest, heaviest, and most luxurious passenger car, it carried a price of over 40,000 Reichmarks, also making it one of the most expensive automobiles of its age. After 2 years of development time, the star model of the sales program was unveiled in autumn 1930 at the Paris Auto Show. Fighting for the rank of the leading German automobile, it was incidentally competing against Maybach's innovative Zeppelin 12-cylinder, which in the previous year had taken the pole position from the types Nürburgring and 630. The official English name of the 770 was Super Mercedes Straight 8. The mighty 8-cylinder inline unit generated 150 horsepower without supercharger and up to 200 horsepower with an optional supercharger. The huge driving mechanism enabled the limousines, which weighed up to 3.5 tons, a top speed of 160 kilometers per hour. Four giant ribbed brake drums accomplished deceleration, each equipped with a vacuum servo. Additionally, a three-gear transmission with optional overdrive offered a choice total of 6 gears, which in this luxury car were probably operated by a chauffeur. The Grand Mercedes was quick to find worldwide adoration. The Japanese imperial family alone ordered 6 between 1932 and 1935. Also in circles of industrialists and aristocrats, this new and exclusive product continuously gained popularity. All vehicles were hand-built and custom-tailored to individual wishes. The cabriolets B, C, D, and F, plus a 7-seat open touring car, completed the range of available chassis styles in September 1932. All variations wore the V-shaped radiator as a common trademark. With only 117 vehicles built, the 770 was, in regards to total production numbers, rather unimportant. And yet, the Grand Mercedes is beyond doubt as an integral part of the Mercedes-Benz myth. In February 1938, the series W07 was replaced by the W150's successor, a type called 770 Grand Mercedes, and of which 88 vehicles were built between 1938 and 1943. The Mercedes-Benz types in the 170 range were not quite as elegant and exclusive as their relatives in the luxury class. But they turned out to be real top sellers and epitomized the company's ability to grow with its tasks. The so-called Weimar Republic was suffering from the Great Depression. A new strategy was called for, and so a new vehicle type was launched in the beginning of the 30s. The Type 170, internally W15, was to secure the survival of the Daimler-Benz AG. Consequently, the aims were high. Smaller dimensions combined with high quality workmanship, affordably priced. In October 1931, the Mercedes-Benz Model 170 was introduced to the world at the Paris Auto Show. Its swing axles at the front and rear, dubbed independent wheel suspension, was a fairly advanced technical feature for the time. The plan worked. In 1932, already 4,438 vehicles had been sold, more than Mercedes-Benz production total in the previous year. Modern technology and the attractive shape of the car made it immensely popular. With a showroom price of 4,000 marks for a four-door sedan, the 170 was one of the most affordable cars in the sales program, in spite of its six-cylinder engine. Within 5 years, 13,775 units of the 170 were sold, plus an additional 126 of the delivery van version, L300. In the spring of 1936, a successor was released, Type 170V of the 136 series. Apart from its cubic capacity, it was a completely new creation with a four-cylinder engine. The vehicle was developed under the direction of board member Dr. Hans Niebuhr, together with the engineer Max Wagner, who supplied it with an X-shaped oval tube frame with a higher wheelbase. It weighed about 50 kilograms less and was more robust than the previously used Type 170 box frame. At the time of the launch, an abundance of body variations already existed. The Type 170V was available as sedan with two or four doors, a cabriolet sedan, open touring car, cabriolet B, and a two-seat roadster. Like its predecessor, the chassis was offered with optional bodies and superstructural parts. In May 1936, the elegant cabriolet A followed as the most exclusive variation for 5,980 Reichmarks. Selling approximately 72,000 units, the 170V, produced between 1936 and 1942, turned out to be the most important pre-war passenger car model by far. The V in the type name indicated a front engine. This distinguished it from Type 170 and its rear engine counterpart, Type 170H, which never really prevailed over the front engine variation. With only 1,507 produced, the 170H, internally called W28, was not a top seller in its day. However, today, it is widely coveted by aficionados. The Mercedes-Benz Model 500K was a fascinating melange of sports car and exclusive luxury automobile. In March 1934, it was presented at the Berlin Automobile Exhibition as the successor of Model 380. It was supposed to attract a performance-orientated and demanding clientele. On the price list, the 500K for compressor started appearing with diverse body styles from June 1934 on. Available were a four-door sedan dubbed interior steering at the time, a two-seat roadster with two emergency seats, the cabriolets A, B, and C, and a two-door open touring car. Every variation fetched a handsome 22,000 Reichmarks. The chassis alone tacked another 15,500 Reichmarks onto the bill. A veritable piece of eye candy, the Roadster was presented in Paris in October 1935. At 28,000 Reichmarks, it was the most expensive variation and still today is one of the most hounded of all automobiles. That those Mercedes models can only be owned by an elite, well-to-do clientele is no surprise. Movie stars, race drivers, and other celebrities turned the compressor Mercedes into a status symbol. The overdrive transmission with semi-automatic shifting epitomized the state of the art. The clutch was not needed for shifting from third gear into overdrive. Furthermore, in April 1936, the cubic capacity of the engine was expanded to 5.4 liters, raising the output to 115 horsepower, 180 with an additional supercharger. From September 1936 on, the designation was changed accordingly. Over the course of time, the former Type 540 with compressor was simply called 540K. All 1930s compressor types were made to order productions, tailored to individual wishes. The beauty and quality of the eight-cylinder car bodies drew admiration to the Sindelfingen facility for limited production. Of both W29 models, 761 chassis were produced between February 1934 and November 1939. 342 of these had a cubic capacity of 5 liters, another 419 of 5.4 liters. all stand among the great automobile legends and often command dizzying sums in collector circles. After the diesel engine successfully passed its practical test in 1924 in the world's first diesel truck, the Benz 5 tons, the production of a diesel passenger car, was within reach. The basic requirement was the pre-chamber principle invented by Prosper Lorange. In autumn 1933, the first experimental engines, 3.86 cylinders with an output of 80 horsepower, were installed into test vehicles of the Mannheim model. Nevertheless, the vibrations proved to be too strong for the chassis and therefore prevented their use in a passenger car. In 1935, under the direction of Chief Engineer Albert Hess, it was finally possible to install a 2.6-liter engine generating 45 horsepower into a lengthened chassis of the Model 200. Daimler-Benz displayed the result at the Berlin Motor Show. The Type 260D in the six-seated Pullman Landau-Lay version. The first 13 vehicles had already been produced since July of the previous year. 260D was the world's first passenger car with a diesel engine. From September 1936, the 260D was on offer in additional body styles, such as the fixed-top Pullman sedan, 4-to-5-seat sedan, and the Cabriolet B seating 4 or 5. Due to the reliability of the CI engine, the 260D was predestined for commercial use as a taxi. At a top speed of almost 100 kilometers per hour, a full 10-liter fuel tank could go 400 to 500 kilometers. The 9,500 Reichmarks price did not make the 260D a special offer, but the economic running costs quickly balanced the investment. Production of the 260D, internally W138, reached up to 1,967 by December 1940. The car proved the advantages of the diesel engine and thus marked the beginning of the diesel car's rise to success. During the war, most of the Daimler-Benz manufacturing plants were destroyed. Production afterwards resumed with the proven model 170V. Although at first, Americans only licensed repairing work on U.S. Army vehicles and the production of delivery vans, which were urgently needed for reconstruction. In May 1946, the first flatbed truck was produced, followed a month later by a delivery van. Ambulance and police cars extended the model range in autumn, and in July 1947, production of the four-door 170V sedan was resumed. In May 1949, the types 170D and 170S were presented, the first newly designed cars. The 170 was outstanding on account of its efficient 1.7-liter diesel engine, which even in those days burned clearly less fuel than its petrol-powered counterpart. The types 170V and 170D benefited from substantial makeovers in May 1950. To differentiate them from the originals, the improved versions were internally called 170VA and DA. Two years later, both models were modified again. Models 170VB and DB were fitted with widened rear axles, bumpers, and an enhanced windshield behind which the wiping mechanism was installed. Additionally, the louvres on the side of the hood were replaced by two horizontal strips. Production of production of the 170V and 170D continued until 1953. The continuing success of the model was mainly due to its efficient performance, reliability, and durability. As the new flagship of its car program in May 1949, Mercedes-Benz presented another spectacular vehicle, the Type 170S. In terms of style and engineering, it was based on the pre-war Type 230. But it differed from its predecessor, having a more powerful engine, an improved front axle, and a more spacious chassis. The range was extended with a two-seat Cabriolet A and a four-seat Cabriolet B. The Cabriolet A especially was regarded as a luxury vehicle and added class to the program. While undergoing substantial improvements in January 1952, the 170S was supplied with a steering column shift and a starter button, amongst other things. The variation was internally called 170B, and its prominent features included an enlarged rear window and internal trunk lid hinges. At the same time, the new Type 170DS was displayed. Equipped with a diesel engine of Type 170DA, it clearly exceeded the sales volume of the petrol-powered sister model. In 1953, the technically advanced follow-ups of the 170SV and the 170SD were introduced as an alternative to the latest design type, 180 Ponton, which was met with immense skepticism by the more traditionally minded customers. The last edition combined the largely unchanged chassis of the predecessors with the more spacious bodies of the 170SB and 170DS respectively. Here again, the diesel version was sold in higher volumes than the gasoline model. Hence, production of the 170SV ended in February 1955, whereas Type 170SD last came off the line in September of the same year. Along with the legendary Adenauer Mercedes, the Mercedes-Benz Type 220, internally W187, debuted at the first International Automobile Show in Frankfurt in 1951. In designing terms, the 220 was largely based on the 170S, and so chassis and body were nearly identical. But the headlights bestowed the vehicle with a brand new face, since they were now integrated into the front fenders. Compensating for the noticeably higher engine performance, the front wheels of the 220 were equipped with duplex drum brakes. An octane compensator made the engine suitable for different fuel qualities. The 220 was alternatively available as sedan. Elegant Cabriolet A. Or four-seat Cabriolet B. The two-seat Cabriolet A was a genuine dream vehicle. The 18,000 Deutschmark price tag and a modest production volume of 1,278 proved its highly exclusive character. In December 1953, another body style was introduced. The new coupe quickly assumed the position of arguably the most exclusive version of Model 220. The basic charge was an exorbitant 20,850 Deutschmarks, plus a sunroof added another 1,150 marks to the bill. Technically and stylistically, the coupe was based on the Cabriolet A, and so both were equipped with new and improved 85 horsepower engines. Production production of the 220 sedan finally ceased in 1954, after a total of 16,156 units. The last cabriolet had already left the Sindelfingen facilities a year before. Only coupes and the Cabriolet A were still manufactured up until August 1955. A magical moment for Mercedes-Benz came about in 1951, the unveiling of an automobile that wrote history. Type 300, internally W186, was the biggest and fastest series produced German car of its time. A refined sedan car of distinguished class, it quickly became the preferred vehicle of famous German statesmen. Outstanding personalities, like Federal Minister Ludwig Erhard, sat in its comfortable back seat. However, the myth revolving around the 300 goes back to the man who shaped the young Federal Republic like no one else, Konrad Adenauer. The first German chancellor just could not do without it, and even traveled abroad in his official car. No wonder the 300 is commonly known today as Adenauer Mercedes. Just like Type 220, the 300 was run by a six-cylinder engine with an overhead camshaft. The first version produced an output of 115 horsepower and reached what was then a stunning top speed of 160 kilometers per hour. The chassis frame design resembled those of types 170S and 220, but was adapted to suit the higher weight and striking performance of the 300. When heavy loads were carried, auxiliary torsion bars could be switched into action in the rear suspension to level the wheels, a completely novel feature of the Adenauer Mercedes, which was also available with a sunroof. Another option, the Cabriolet D with five or six seats. The first substantial improvements were carried out in 1954. The output of the new version, internally dubbed 300B, was raised to 125 horsepower. Brake shoes were enhanced and brake boosters added. What made the 300B distinguishable were front ventipanes, chrome fittings on the rear fenders, and overriders on both sides. A new modified Type 300 was released in 1955. The new version, internally called 300C, was discernible by its broadened rear window and the bigger tires. It was also provided with a single joint swing axle. As an extra, Mercedes-Benz offered an automatic transmission for the first time. In the summer of 1957, another thoroughly revised version was introduced. Technically and stylistically, the new 300 clearly differed from its predecessor. Its design designation, W189, separated the internally named 300D into an independent model range. The fuel in the engine was not atomized by a carburetor, but by direct fuel injection, which propelled the output of the 300D to 160 horsepower. By request, the new Adenauer Mercedes was available with servo steering, and starting from December 1958, even with air conditioning. Incidentally, for the first time in a Mercedes-Benz passenger car. First and foremost, the body was modernized, which became apparent with the broadened window areas. The range was complemented again with a Cabriolet D, with an added sum of 8,500 marks another exclusive variation with an impressive appearance up to this day.
Der Gewinner ist jeder Käufer eines Mercedes-Benz-Wagens, denn die gewonnenen Erfahrungen kommen ihm in allen Fahrzeugen, die den Mercedes-Benz-Stern tragen, zugute. Sie werden ehrlich überrascht sein und ebenso ausgeruht in die Konferenz kommen wie diese beiden Herren.
In October 1951, a new sensation debuted at the Paris Auto Show. Type 300S, without a doubt, one of the most attractive cars of its epoch. It was positioned as a prestigious car with a sporty flair, which could satisfy the highest demands in road holding and speed. This was echoed in reviews by the international trade press, which celebrated the new model as vehicle for the world's elite and benchmark for what is obtainable in today's car production. Technically, the 300S was mostly based on the Adenauer Mercedes. The wheelbase was shortened by 150 millimeters, while the engine performance was heightened. With an output of 150 horsepower, the 300S sped up to 175 kilometers per hour, even leaving a Porsche effortlessly behind. The 300S was offered as Cabriolet A, Roadster, or Coupe. A total of 560 units had been built before a customized version entered the market in 1955. The most profound changes were with the rear axle and engine. The internally called 300SC was provided with a single joint swing axle that had a lower pivotal point. The fuel mixture was not aspirated by three carburetors, but with direct fuel injection. With the parallel increase of compression, the engine's output was raised to 175 horsepower. A prestigious chrome label alluding to it read Einspritzmotor and could be found under the trunk handle at the back. In spite of technical and visual improvements of all three types of the 300SC, only a total amount of 200 units were produced. No wonder, since the 300SL Roadster, which was available from 1957 on, was 4,000 marks cheaper, despite its modern design and advanced driving performance. Nevertheless, both versions of the 188 range are counted among the most exclusive post-war Mercedes-Benz passenger cars, and are today sought-after collector's cars. In September 1953, Mercedes-Benz presented its first passenger car with a body in ponton style. Type 180 had fully integrated fenders and a rectangular outline, a design that considerably reduced air resistance and the sound of wind, and at the same time allowed a more spacious interior. Another novelty was the integral body, which for the first time was designed to be welded to the chassis. In January 1954, the 120 series was supplemented with model 180D, almost identical to its gasoline-powered sister model. Both types benefited from September 1955 on from the new single-joint swing axle, which was introduced in Type 220A 1.5 years previously. In March 1956, a third model joined the four-cylinder range. Type 190 was characterized by an engine that could hit 75 horsepower. Although it originated from the 190SL, it was considerably tamer. The brakes were adapted and equipped with ribbed turbo-cooled brake drums. With the motto, more precious but not more expensive, the modified Type 180A followed in the summer of 1957, now also equipped with a 1.9-liter engine. About a year later, a second diesel model, the 190D, with an output of 50 horsepower, joined it and became an immediate sales hit. The modernized versions 180B, 180DB, 190B, and 190DB from 1959 were memorable for their radiator grills and bulky bumpers. The Ponton four cylinders received its final makeover in August 1961. The drive of the 180C was slightly modified, while the 180DC was equipped with a completely new engine. Mercedes-Benz Ponton era ended in autumn 1962. In 9 years, a total of 442,963 units of the four-cylinder range had been built. While the four-cylinder Ponton types were positioned in the mid-range, Type 220A, which was introduced in March 1954, clearly targeted the upper class. The six-cylinder type was given the self-supporting body in Ponton shape, and at a quick glance could hardly be differentiated from its little brothers. However, the wheelbase of the 220A was greater by 170 millimeters, allowing for extra legroom in the back. The hood on both sides of the radiator grille was almost flush with the bumper. Air vents were positioned behind the series-produced fog lamps, and the front indicators were set in chrome cases mounted on the very front of the fender. The six-cylinder engine of the 220A descended from its predecessor of the 187 range, but it was modified in certain ways, which was noticeable with its 85 horsepower output. In March 1956, types 219 and 220S were launched as successors of the first six-cylinder model with a Ponton body. The performance of the 200S was raised to 100 horsepower by two tow-phase carburetors. Model 219, on the other hand, internally called W105, was to some degree a hybrid. Derived from models 190 and 220, it was supposed to target new customers as a budget-priced basic model. About 2 years later, another new six-cylinder model was released, the 220SE. The model, internally known as W128, mostly resembled the 220S, but was additionally supplied with a fuel-injected engine and raised the output to a stunning 115 horsepower. With its higher price and a limited total production volume of 1,974, it was the most exclusive model of the range. In August 1959, the types 219, 220S, and 220SE were succeeded by the new Fintail model range 111. In 5 years of production time, 111,035 six-cylinder saloons with Ponton body came into being. From a technical point of view, all Mercedes saloons since then have a Ponton-shaped body. Nevertheless, the name Ponton Mercedes is reserved for the original model generation. It was to become the legendary gullwing in the history of the automobile. The 300 SL Coupe, the first post-war thoroughbred Mercedes-Benz sports car. Conceptually, this dream vehicle with a dream price of 29,900 marks, which was internally called W198, was based on the racing model 300 SL, which celebrated triumphant victories throughout 1952. The American importer Max Hoffman was foremost in pushing development of a serialized version. The result was presented in February 1954 at the International Motorsports Show in New York. The most striking feature it shared with the 52 model was the famous wing doors, hence the English name Gullwing. Although an obvious eye-catcher even today, this unusual solution stemmed only from a small engineering snag. The tubular frame borrowed from the SL Racer could not bear conventional doors. Further innovations were hidden under the streamlined body. For the first time in a serialized car, direct fuel injection was integrated. This 215 horsepower engine had to be tilted to allow for a flattened front end, The consistent lightweight construction resulted in spectacular performances, hitting top speeds between 235 and 260 kilometers per hour. May 1957 saw the last of the 1,400 Gullwing coupe units go forth from the Sindelfingen line. Its successor was introduced later the same year at the auto show in Geneva. Once again, Max Hoffmann's tireless campaigning pushed the 300 SL Roadster's development as he foresaw great sales opportunities for an open top on the U.S. market. Technically, the Roadster largely reflected its predecessor, but this modified frame allowed conventional doors. The rear suspension arms were substantially improved by lowering the axle's central pivot point, like the 220A. From October 1958 on, a detachable coupe roof was available as an extra for the price of 1,500 marks. The 300 SL Roadster 1961 was endowed with Dunlop disc brakes on all wheels. In 1962, a modified engine with a light metal block rounded the makeover off. Production in Sindelfingen ceased on February 8, 1963. This date marked the end of an epoch for Daimler-Benz. With the 300 SL, the last passenger car with a detached frame disappeared from the program. Roadsters like the Gullwing Coupe were collector's items from the start and have retained their allure to the present day. For many years, they have been amongst the most sought-after classics. Mercedes-Benz started developing a new sports car based on the Type 180 range in 1953. Unlike the famous Gullwing Coupe, the 190 SL Roadster, internally W121, was not a thoroughbred sports car, but a graceful, sportive, and above all, travel-suitable two-seater. The body style was strongly reminiscent of its big brother, the 300 SL. And the floor plan was a shortened version of the Mercedes 180. Its dependable road holding, praised by the trade press, was on account of the coil spring equipped single joint swing axles and their low pivotal point. The 190 SL was powered by a newly developed four-cylinder engine with an overhead camshaft, boosting 105 horsepower. Incidentally, this became the ancestor of a whole family of engines and accelerated the Roadster to a top speed of over 170 kilometers per hour. It cost the then enormous sum of 16,000 marks. The international unveiling of the 190 SL, together with the 300 SL, was held in February 1954 at the Motor Sports Show in New York. Substantially improved, the 190 SL entered series production in May 1955. It was available in three different variations: as a roadster with convertible top, but without coupe top, and as coupe with detachable hard top, optional with or without convertible top. A total of 25,881 units were produced in the Sindelfingen plant by 1963, the majority of which went to the U.S. market.
Geheimnisse in Untertürkheim. Neuer Typ bei Daimler-Benz. kein Zweifel, ein neuer Mercedes.
At the Frankfurt Auto Show in 1961, Mercedes-Benz presented the four-cylinder types 190C and 190DC of the new 110 series, just like the larger six cylinders with fintail body. The three-box bodywork culminated in the new fintail four-cylinder models. For the first time in the company's history, mid and upper range not only incorporated the same engines and components, but they also displayed an almost identical body. Thus, passengers in mid-range models could also enjoy a spacious interior. Despite the standardized body, the new four-cylinder types could be distinguished from the six cylinders with a glance to the front. The 190s had round headlights and were clearly shorter. A new and stronger diesel engine in the 190DC generated 55 horsepower. In August 1965, improved versions of the four-cylinder models entered the market, with the new designations 200 and 200D. The last Fintail models left the assembly line in February 1968. A total volume of 622,453 sedans and 5,859 chassis with partial bodies came from the Sindelfingen plant. The new six-cylinder, a class of its own. This model launched three freshly designed six-cylinders in August 1959. Apart from single accessories, the types 220B, 220SB and 220SEB only differed in terms of engine specifications. The series, internally W111, set a benchmark concerning passive safety. For the first time, a safety cage with deformation zones in front and rear was incorporated into a passenger car. In the interior, safety was the primary aim in providing a padded dashboard with lowered switches and a steering wheel with padded horn ring. The engine range was carried over from 4Runner models with slight modifications, so that the 220B now had an output of 95 horsepower, while the 220SEB even boasted 120 horsepower. A new upper range model was introduced in September 1961. The type 300SE exhibited numerous technical innovations, such as a four-gear automatic transmission, newly developed servo steering, and for the first time in a Mercedes-Benz, air suspension. In 1963, the subsequent 300SE had its wheelbase extended by 100 millimeters, and an electrically operated partition could be installed upon special request. Assembly of the 2.2 and 3-liter fintails ceased in the summer of 1965, when the 200B was replaced by type 230S, which was supplied with a hydropneumatic compensator spring at the rear axle. In addition, the engine was modified. Although the 230S started out with the character of an obsolescent model, 41,107 units were produced up until January 1968. A total of 344,751 sedans and chassis of the ranges 111 and 112 left the Sindelfingen plant. The new sports car 230SL, which Mercedes-Benz premiered in 1963, was to replace two former models at once, the 190SL and the 300SL. Therefore, so the 230SL was neither an uncompromisingly hard roadster nor a gentle boulevard sports car, but a two-seater, both sleek and travel-suited, combining high comfort with maximum safety. However, this sports car, internally W113, was not an entirely new design. In engineering terms, it closely resembled the 220 SE, to which it also owed its 2.2-liter engine. Its output could be raised to 150 horsepower, and for the first time in an SL model, a four-gear automatic transmission was optional. The 230 SL was the first sports car in the world to incorporate a safety cage with front and rear crumble zones. A characterizing feature was the removable coupe hardtop, which on the new Roadster was concave and slightly dipped in the center. In those days, an unfamiliar Vanguard design which did not receive undivided approval. It was not just a self-serving gimmick though, but highly stabilized, a lightweight construction. Like its predecessor, the 230 SL was available in three options: Roadster with convertible top, Coupe with removable hardtop, and Coupe with both hard and Roadster convertible top. In 1967, the 250 SL replaced the 230 SL, which had been produced for 4 years. Motor and brakes were derived from the 250 SE and slightly modified for use in the Roadster. A year later, the SL was supplied with a new 2.8-liter engine that mobilized 170 horsepower. Apart from the type sign, the new 280 SL differed from its predecessors only by the modified ornamental wheel cap. Production finally ceased in March 1971. All three SL types of the 113 range had a joint production total of 48,912. Alluding to their distinctive hardtop, they are commonly called Pagoda SL today. Revealed to the public in 1963, Type 600 had a spectacular debut. Internally, W100, it was designed for prestige and entered production as the new top model with numerous technical innovations. For instance, a V8 fuel injection engine. With a 6.3-liter cubic capacity, it boasted a maximum output of 250 horsepower and 500 newton torque threshold. With its serialized automatic transmission, the 600, which weighed almost 2.5 tons, easily achieved the performance of a sports car. The luxury car's top speed was over 205 kilometers per hour, going from 0 to 100 in 10 seconds. The greatest possible safety was provided by shock absorbers that could be adjusted while driving, and a dual circular brake system engaged by air pressure. Along with central locking, the abundant standard equipment included electronic heating and cooling systems. Unique for their time, the hydraulic seats were adjustable and doors could be opened and closed automatically, of course. Apart from the 5- to 6-seat sedan, three Pullman variations with longer wheelbases were available. A four-door sedan with a vis-a-vis seating arrangement in the rear. A six-door sedan with bench seat and additional folding seats facing the front, plus a Pullman landaulet. This most exclusive variant could not be found in any price list. Only on request, it was offered reinforced armor for special protection. The well-heeled customer could choose from wide varieties of interior design, finishes and accessories, so that no car had its equal. The last of a total of 2,677 customized orders was produced in June 1981. In the upper range, the types 250S, 250SE, and 300SE started the succession of these six-cylinder fintails in 1965. The elegant outline of the body, first sketched by Paul Braque, is of a timeless grace. Starting in March 1966, the 300SEL supplemented the range. In contrast to its origin, the wheelbase is 100 millimeters longer, which benefited the footwell in the rear. Just like its fintail predecessor with the same designation, the 300SEL was manufactured with pneumatic shock absorption. Internally, the types with conventional suspension were subsumed under series W108, while the air-suspended 300SEL was assigned to an independent series called W109. In the beginning of 1968, the 250SE and 300SE were terminated. Launched in their stead, the 280S and 280SE wore a new look and had more powerful engines. The new front runner in March 1968 was the 300SEL 6.3. With a V8 engine and the automatic transmission of a 600, it was endowed with the performance potential of a high-quality sports car. The 6.3 was only distinguishable from the outside by its wider tires and halogen double headlights with auxiliary brights. The 300SEL 6.3 found its customers and was built a 6,526 times, although it cost over 10,000 marks more than the 280SE. The climax of the range followed in autumn of 1969 with the 300SEL 3.5 that had an output of 200 horsepower, generated by a newly constructed 3.5-liter V8 engine. Production of ranges W108 and 109 ceased in September of 1972 after achieving a joint total of 330,000 units. Successors were the models of range 116, designated S-Class. France, 1894. The first automobile race between Paris and Rouen marked the beginning of motorsport. Out of 102 registered vehicles, 21 actually started and only 15 reached the destination after 126 kilometers. And of these, 9 were propelled by Daimler engines. A few years later, a genuine sports car replaced the previous carriage type vehicles. It was ordered by Emil Jelinek, who named it after his daughter. The Mercedes 35 horsepower was almost a third lighter than its predecessor, and with a top speed of 86 kilometers per hour, a real high-performance automobile. In March 1901, the Mercedes 35 horsepower dominated the Nice Speed Week, the legendary automobile race in the south of France. The victories of this first Mercedes were so impressive that Paul Meillant, Secretary General of the French Automobile Club, enthusiastically wrote, "We have entered the era Mercedes." Major victories for the star were scored by Christian Lautenschlager, a former mechanic of the Daimler Motorengesellschaft. At the French Grand Prix in 1908, he won in a Mercedes 140 HP, with a spectacular speed of 111 kilometers per hour. The story of success was continued in the New World. In 1910, two Benz 150 horsepower vehicles stole the first two places in Savannah. And while war was being waged in Europe, the American Rolf De Palma clinched a victory at the Indianapolis 500-mile race. He crossed the finish with his Mercedes 115 HP Grand Prix in record time at an average speed of almost 145 kilometers per hour. In 1932, the International Motor Racing Authority prescribed a new formula, limiting the weight of a vehicle without driver to 750 kilograms. In spite of the tight times, Daimler-Benz developed vehicles to meet the specifications. After a 9-year break, the first new Grand Prix racing car was finally produced, internally designated W25. The 8-cylinder engine pushed 354 horsepower. Another novelty was the independent suspension. In June 1934, a day before the race, the W25 was officially weighed in at 1 kilogram above the limit. An old idiom using the word lacquer to mean swindled gave the racing manager Alfred Neubauer an idea. Overnight, he had the white paint coat scraped off, and the W25 reappeared in naked aluminum. Thus, the regulation weight was reached. The first entry of the W25 in the international Eifel race was a resounding success. Manfred von Brauchitsch not only won the race, but set a new record. The name of the unbeatable Silver Arrow, coined by the press, caught on fast, prompting Daimler-Benz to keep the color for its racing cars. The 1931 season brought 4 further victories for the star, and ended with a duel between Mercedes-Benz and Auto Union, which lasted into the following year. ...1935 was an extraordinarily successful year. Mercedes swept up victories in 9 out of 10 races, including 5 1-2 finishes. Rudolf Caracciola, who in 1926 had won the German Grand Prix under extremely difficult weather conditions, celebrated his spectacular comeback. Of the 9 victories of the season, he clinched 6. In the same year, he became European champion and was celebrated as a major star. In 1936, a string of bad luck hit the star. Auto Union's 16-cylinder race car, designed by Ferdinand Porsche, was dominating all the races. The Daimler-Benz company's reaction was to set up an independent racing department, headed by a young engineer and gifted test driver, Rudolf Uhlenhaut. After thoroughly testing the W25, he developed the new W125, which made an impressive comeback in 1937, stealing victory after victory. The unforgettable climax was the Avus race, which was the fastest race in its time, with top speeds of up to 380 kilometers per hour. The average speed of 260 kilometers per hour was only surpassed in 1959. The ever-increasing speed under the 750 kilogram limit was finally considered too dangerous. In 1938, a new formula was introduced, limiting the cubic capacity to 3 liters. In the same year, Rudolf Caracciola took the European Championship again, with the W154, followed by the German road race. Next year, in the Tripoli Grand Prix, only 1.5-liter racing cars were allowed to enter. This was a strategy of the organizers. In order to enhance the chances of the newly tested 1.5-liter Italian racing car against the intimidating predominance of the German racing cars, Daimler-Benz discreetly developed the W165 in only 8 months. After a single trial journey a few days prior to the race, 2 W165 models started against a majority of 28 Italian and English racing cars and scored an awesome double victory. Hermann Lang came in first with an average speed of 197.8 kilometers per hour, and Rudolf Caracciola in second. Mercedes-Benz successfully re-entered the racing world 7 years after World War II. The 1952 racing season revolved around the 300 SL Sports racing car. With the legendary Goldwing, Hermann Lange and Carl Kling clinched victories at the Grand Prix in Bern, the 24 Hours of Le Mans, the Nürburgring Anniversary Prize, and the third Carrera Panamericana in Mexico. The comeback in the Formula One in summer 1954 could not have been better timed. It was the big anniversary year for motorsport. For the first time, the W196 Formula racing car was entered into the French Grand Prix. With this car, Juan Manuel Fangio drove to victory, exactly 40 years after the memorable triple triumph of the Mercedes vehicles and parallel with the victory of the Football World Championship. Second came Carl Kling, a tremendous start of the season. Another memorable event for Mercedes-Benz was the Avus race. Carl Kling won with an average speed of 213.5 kilometers per hour, followed by Juan Manuel Fangio and Hans Hermann taking second to third. Fangio rounded off an exceptionally successful season with the World Championship title. Especially for Stirling Moss, a new member in the Mercedes racing team, the star determined the 1955 season. It started with the Grand Prix of Argentina. W196 was entered with an improved chassis, new wheels, and enhanced engine performance. The conditions were extreme. On account of the sweltering heat, drivers fainted one after the other. Only Fangio held out, and after 3 hours, crossed the line as the winner. Stirling Moss gained his first victory in his home country at the Grand Prix of Great Britain. Juan Manuel Fangio ended this year also with the World Championship, Stirling Moss as runner-up. 1955, a new racing car replaced the Goldwing. The 300 SLR, internally dubbed W196S. In it, Stirling Moss not only won the Tourist Trophy and Targa Florio, but celebrated one of his biggest triumphs, the legendary Mille Miglia, 1,000 miles in an awe-inspiring 10 hours, 7 minutes, and 48 seconds, a record unsurpassed to this day. Despite the thriving season, a decision to withdraw from racing was made, just when a serious accident occurred in Le Mans. Still, the racing season of 1955 ended victoriously. Apart from the Formula One World Championship, Mercedes-Benz was awarded the brand prize in the German touring competition and the European touring car title. A further milestone in Mercedes-Benz motorsport history is without a doubt the racing series of Group C, reviving the tradition of sports car racing since 1982. Peter Zauber, a Swiss race car engineer, was one of the pioneers. His quest for a stronger engine led him to the Daimler-Benz company in 1985, where he was welcomed, and from then on, a racing engine based on the series motor M117 was hidden in the back of every Zauber C8. At the first trial, it boosted output to 700 horsepower. The return of the silver arrows in 1989 revived the traditional silver varnish look of the famed 1930s Mercedes-Benz racers. Now the recently conceived M119HL, a VH four-valve engine, rocketed its power up to 925 horsepower. During its two-year lifetime, the powerhouse engine won 16 out of 18 races, including the 1989 and 90 Sports Car World Championship with the team Sauber Mercedes. In 1991, the rules for Group C were changed. Turbocharged engines were not accepted anymore. The cubic capacity was limited to 3.5 liters and the dry weight to 750 kilograms. Supported by Mercedes-Benz, Sauber developed the 12-cylinder racing car C291. But the World Championship went to Jaguar in this year. Only in the last race of the season, the team of Michael Schumacher and Karl Wendlinger won in a C291. The successor C292 was already waiting in the wings when on November 26, 1991, the Daimler-Benz board decided to withdraw from Group C. In 1968, the first People's Mercedes was launched. Stroke 8, named in reference to its debut year, was an entirely new concept. The cars, internally called W114 and 115, won the hearts of the customers, and about 2 million units left the assembly line, as much as the total Mercedes-Benz production sum from 1945 until 1968. The plain body shape and the technical innovations responded to the customer's needs. The chassis was noticeably restructured. Additionally, Stroke 8 was supplied with a new rear axle, dubbed the diagonal swing axle, which allowed safe road handling. Regarding safety, W114 and 115 were manufactured with 4-disc brakes. Today, a worldwide standard. The original model variations of the range included 6 types, from the 200D with a 55 horsepower 4-cylinder diesel engine to the 250 with a 130 horsepower 6-cylinder carburetor engine. The superior type 250 was easily distinguishable by its outer appearance. It was the only one with a double bar front bumper. All diesel and gasoline-fueled 4-cylinders were assigned to the 115 series, and all 6-cylinders to the 114 series. The interior of this small Mercedes was plain, but enriched with numerous novelties, attributing to a pleasant drive, like the center console. During the 1973 revamping, the safety of W114 and 115 was enhanced. The range featured a number of details previously introduced with the SL and SLC types and the S-Class. Interior-controlled wing mirrors, dirt-repellent decorative screens at the A-pillars in order to keep the side windows clean in bad weather, molded dirt-repellent rear lights, and drip molding at the back window. From March 1973 on, headrests and automatic seat belts in the front became standard in the series provisions. During development, new trials in active and passive safety were performed. Another novelty was wipers on the front lights. And already then, Mercedes-Benz began testing a phenomenal invention, the airbag. The improved models had also been visually adapted to fit the appearance of the S-Class. The radiator grille was lower and wider. The side ventipanes were removed. The license plate Orifix was attached onto instead of below the bumper, and the trunk handle altered. Also, the front end edge matched its older brother's outfit. Types 250 to 280E lost their front double bumpers, just like the coupe models. The visually upgraded types 280 and 280E were the only sedans of the model range that kept the rear bumper. In the course of a makeover in autumn 1973, two new four-cylinder engines were installed. Type 240D was the top of the diesel model range, while Type 230.4 replaced the 220. The 4 in the type designation of the new 230 was necessary to avoid confusion with the original 230, which additionally had a six-cylinder motor and was still available as Type 230.6. In July 1974, the model range was once more enhanced. Type 240D 3.0 was introduced to the world as the first five-cylinder diesel, whose engine could produce 80 horsepower. In the context of the time, an extraordinary achievement. Apart from the Stroke 8 sedans, a coupe variant was introduced, a complete novelty in the mid-range. First serialized were types 250C and 250CE, followed by types 280C and 280CE. The Stroke 8 coupes entered the market with the superior engine of the six-cylinder sedans. Design and accessories were first matched to the sedans, and in the 70s, they corresponded more and more with that of its older brother, the SLC coupe. In January 1976, the successors of Series 114 and 115 appeared on the stage. Series 123, which was already being manufactured. Production of the Stroke 8 types did not stop immediately, but was continued until December 1976, so that both series were produced in unison for about a year. Types 250 to 280E and the coupes were all discontinued separately between June and September 1976. To date, the W114 and W115 still exhibit consistent high-quality workmanship, even after so many years. A wear and tear car for daily use that has retained its allure for fans and collectors all over the world. In spring 1971, Mercedes-Benz premiered a sports car with an entirely new technical makeup, the 350 SL. This youngest SL generation marked the turn from an uncompromising hard sports car to a high-performance luxury roadster. A timeless body outline combined with typical Mercedes-Benz virtues made it a genuine sales hit, until today. The internally called R107 stayed true to the traditional concept of the whole range. As a two-seater with convertible and removable hardtop, the new one hardly had anything in common with its predecessor, the Pagoda SL that was built until 1968. The front and rear wheel suspension of the 1972 released S-Class Range 116 derived from its stylistic forerunner, the now legendary Stroke 8. The motor was a tested and proven V8 engine taken from the sedans, coupes and cabriolets of type 280 3.5. From 1973 on, a 4.5 liter V8 engine was also available. The interior was furnished with an eye to safety and appeared factual and functional. the ergonomic seat position supported a healthy posture. The SL was also a role model in regards to passive safety. The fuel tank was for the first time installed above the rear axle and thus protected from collision. Additional impact protection was provided by a retractable steering column and padded upholstery with adjustable switches. In 1973, the SL was re-equipped with a four-gear automatic transmission and the light metal alloy engine of the S-Class. As reaction to the worldwide oil crisis in the previous year, Mercedes-Benz launched the fuel-efficient 280 SL. For the first time in the history of the SL type range, three vehicles with three different engines were available. New type designations were introduced in 1980. The 350 SL became the 380 SL. The 450 SL was succeeded by a new type, the 500 SL, which was recognizable by its rubber rear spoiler. Also in 1985, finally a 3-liter six-cylinder engine was premiered and gave rise to a new roadster with the magical 300 SL designation. In August of 89, the last SL of the type R107 rolled off the assembly line after over 8 years of production, which was an unsurpassed record in itself. No other passenger car from the house of Mercedes-Benz was manufactured for such a long time. All in all, 237,287 vehicles were built. In 1972, a new product line started under the internal code C107. The SLC, closest relative to the SL. Apart from the coupe's hardtop, both variants were identical down to the inner door shell. The lengthened wheelbase allowed for four seats. Other novelties lay in the technical makeup.
Das sichere Zweikreis Servobremssystem mit vorderen innenbelüfteten Scheibenbremsen. Das spurstabile Fahrwerk, hinten die Mercedes-Benz Diagonalpendelachse, sind Beiträge zur aktiven Sicherheit. Das Herz des 350 SLC, der 3,5 Liter V8 Motor mit elektronisch gesteuerter Einspritzung, Transistorzündung und oben liegenden Nockenwellen. Dieses 200 PS starke Aggregat beschleunigt das Coupé in 8,8 Sekunden von 0 auf 100 Stundenkilometer.
In April 1973, a new V8 engine became available that specified an enhanced cylinder capacity of 4.5 liters and generated 225 horsepower. The classy interior combined the comfort and spaciousness of a saloon with the sporty character of the SL Roadster. For passengers in the rear seats, the SLC was equally suitable for travel. As with the Roadster, the coupe was bestowed with various safety measures, such as the safety steering unit, which heightened impact protection. The top model of the range debuted in 1977, the 450 SLC 5.0, characterized by a new light metal alloy engine and reduced weight. Prominent identifying features included a discrete front spoiler, a black plastic rear spoiler, and the gray finish under the body side molding. In 1980, the coupe was technically updated to the S-Class level, with an optimized engine performance and refurbished interior. The type designation was modified accordingly. The 450 SLC 5.0 became the 500 SLC. The 380 SLC replaced the 350 SLC. The SLC proved its sport merits at the famous Bandama Rally at the Ivory Coast in Africa. In December, the Mercedes team clutched a four-time victory in the 450 SLC 5.0. In 1981, about 1.5 years after the last makeover, the coupes of the 107 series had to make way for a new variant. In a 10-year production span, a total of 62,888 units were produced, sought after collector's cars to this day. In 1976, Mercedes-Benz unveiled a whole new generation of mid-range sedans to the public in Bandol, south of France. No less than 9 different gasoline and diesel variations were heir to the popular and robust Stroke 8. Comfort and driving performance benefited from the lengthening of wheelbase and front wheel track.
Der Fahrer nimmt wahr, verarbeitet, entscheidet, handelt.
Technically, the new model range was styled after the S-Class, which had been produced for 3 years. It was correspondingly provided with a semi-trailing arm rear axle and a double wishbone front wheel suspension.
Fahrwerk und Lenkung signalisieren den Grenzwert der Haftung. Mit erstklassiger Technik lassen sich auch schwierige Situationen meistern.
Irgendwann geht da jedes Auto weg. Unseres soll es später tun.
A striking design feature was the big round double headlights. The top models 280 and 280E were equipped with rectangular broadband halogen lights. At the beginning of production, the 123 sedan came with a 2-liter diesel engine, providing 55 horsepower, and a high-performance 2.8-liter fuel injection producing 185 horsepower. 2 new gasoline engines were added, a 2-liter carburetor engine with 109 horsepower, and a fuel injection with an output of 136 horsepower. The interior was available with a wide variety of accessories and allowed a choice based on individual taste and budget. For instance, the seat upholstery came in different colors and fabrics, like velour, MB Tex, or leather. Safety was enhanced with an improved safety cage and a reinforced top frame structure. The latest safety development was the safety steering column, which connected steering aggregate and steering column jacket by a corrugated pipe so that the column was prevented from penetrating the interior.
Mit Gurt vervielfacht sich die Überlebenschance bei einem Unfall. Selbst der stärkste Mann der Welt könnte sich bestenfalls gegen einen Frontalaufprall von 15 Kilometern pro Stunde wehren. 15 Kilometer pro Stunde. Nicht mehr. Frontalaufprall mit 50 Kilometern Geschwindigkeit und Versuch mit dem Airbag, dem Luftsack.
It was available for an extra charge of a lavish 1,579 marks. The first makeover in 1977 resulted in 3 body variants. A coupe, another sedan with longer wheelbase, and an independent variation of the T. In 1978, the output of the 280E was boosted to 185 horsepower, while the 240D produced 72 horsepower. A year later, the 200D achieved 5 horsepower more. The 220D was abandoned, and the engines of the 300D and the 250 were substantially modified. In 1980, a 2-liter carburetor engine and a 136 horsepower fuel injection replaced the season forerunners. The additional makeover of 1982 was beneficial for all models of the range. Noteworthy in this context was the series produced servo steering. Prominent features of the new 123s were the rectangular headlights. Taxi drivers especially profited from the numerous improvements in the safety area.
Ach, und jetzt auch noch diese beiden Typen. Wo fahren die denn hin? Ach, oh Backe, zum alten Güterbahnhof. Was versteckt er bloß unter seiner Jacke? Ein Glück, dass ich sie in meinem Tandemspiegel beobachten kann. Und wenn es hart auf hart geht, habe ich ja immer noch meine Alarmanlage.
Der Druck auf einen individuell zu installierenden Knopf setzt auch während der Fahrt das Alarmsystem in Betrieb.
The 123s also obtained honors in sports with hard endurance grinding rallies. Almost 2.7 million vehicles left the assembly line by the end of the range in 1985.
Wo brennst du denn?
Ja.
Reparatur?
Nein.
Große Inspektion? Auch nicht. Verliert ihr?
Nein.
Da läuft unruhig?
Nein.
Nein, auch nicht.
Tut mir leid, im Wagen fehlt nichts.
Na und was wollen Sie denn hier?
Die Kinder müssen mal.
Ah, die Kinder müssen mal. Die Kinder müssen mal.
In 1979, Mercedes-Benz for the first time introduced its own station wagon, listed under T for Transport and Tourism. The third body variant, called T Model, made the station wagon a society vehicle, conquering a new class of customers. The stunning success caused waiting lists of up to 3 years, with demand outstripping supply. In technical and stylistical terms, the T model was obviously derived from the 123 sedan, with only the rear as a distinguishing feature.
Der Trickfilm veranschaulicht nochmal, wie vielseitig sich der Mercedes T für Passagiere und Zuladung verwandeln lässt. Durchgehende Sitzbank im Fond. Rest Laderaum. Auf Wunsch Kindersitzbank zusätzlich. Plus Kopfstützen, beidseitig nutzbar. Vorn Sitzbank hoch, Lehne runtergeklappt, Laderaum größer. Sitzbank raus, Laderaum noch größer. Beifahrersitz nach vorn, Lehne zurück, durchgehender Gepäckraum bis zum Armaturenbrett. Auf Wunsch im Vorn geteilte Sitze. Ein breiterer Zweidrittel, ein schmalerer Eindrittelsitz. Mit Kindersitzbank Raum für 6 bis 7 Personen. Kindersitzbank mit 2 Griffen voll versenkt. Zweidrittel Vornsitz umgelegt. Raum für 3 Personen und für noch mehr Gepäck. Sitzbank raus und Laderaum nochmal vergrößert. Andersherum. Ein Drittel Sitz geklappt, gibt Platz für 4 Personen. Beifahrer Rücklehne herunter, 3 Personen und langes Ladegut sind kein Problem. Platz für 2, mehr Raum für Ladung. Und so verschenkt der Fahrer keinen Zentimeter Laderaum.
Initially, the model range included the diesel 240 TD. The gasoline models 230T and 250T, and the top model 280TE. This last one stuck out visually with rectangular broadband lights and a chromed air vent grille in front of the windshield. The T model's interior exuded the laid-back atmosphere of a sedan. Limited storage space due to the slanted rear was more than compensated for by the overall stunning visual appearance. In safety concerns, the 123 model family was also ahead of its time. A restructured passenger car and the technically advanced safety steering column provided the best possible passenger protection. The station wagons also benefited from the updated sedan engines. In September 1978, the output of the 240 TD was pushed to 72 horsepower. From 1979 on, the performances of the 300 TD's 5-cylinder engine and the 6-cylinder carburetor engine of the 250T were heightened. And another year later, the type range was rounded off with the newly introduced 4-cylinders 230 TE and 200T. A new top model debuted in 1980, the 300 TD turbo diesel, the first German Mercedes passenger car with a turbo engine. From 1982 on, all models of the range left the assembly line with upgraded interior and series-produced servo steering. The first generation of T models was produced for almost 8 years. Until the end of the range in 1986, 199,517 units had been produced and became the trendsetter in the genre of lifestyle station wagons, which are quite popular today.
Als Autofahrer sind Sie nicht immer derselbe. Schließlich nutzen Sie Ihr Auto nicht nur beruflich, sondern auch in der Freizeit. Vielleicht segeln Sie gerne oder Ihr Hobby sind Heimwerkerarbeiten. Wenn Sie eine Familie haben, fahren Sie sicherlich gern mit den Kindern ins Grüne. Oder Sie besitzen eigenes Grün, einen eigenen Garten. Vielleicht fahren Sie mit dem eigenen Wagen in Urlaub, im Sommer oder im Winter. Oder Sie wollen Ihre Frau zum Essen ausführen. Dann sollte Ihr Auto nicht weniger vielseitig sein als Sie. Sollte Ihnen in der Freizeit und im Beruf zur Seite stehen.
In 1977, Mercedes-Benz brought yet another variation of the 123 series into being. The coupes 230C, 280C, and 280CE took over from the Stroke 8 coupes. The elegant 123 coupes surprised contemporaries with a sleek profile. Lavish chrome fittings underlined the prominent character of the coupe, which was built without B-pillars. The coupe's mechanical makeup was similar to that of the sedans. Maneuverability was improved by a semi-trailing arm rear axle, plus a double wishbone suspension in the front. The unique style of the two-door version was owed to the 85mm shorter wheelbase. The coupe's engines correlated one-to-one with the sedan specifications. A wide selection of special accessories promised an individualized interior according to taste and pocketbook. Upholstery came in different colors and in textile or leather. Great strides were made regarding the safety of the new coupe range. Noteworthy steps included an improved safety cage with stiffened top frame structure, high-strength roof pillar, and reinforced doors. In 1978, the coupes underwent their first overhaul. Together with the sedans, the horsepower of the 2.8-liter fuel injection engine now measured 185. In 1980, the 230C received a completely new engine, which transformed it into a 136 horsepower strong CE. Remarkably, by request, the types 230 CE and 280 CE were, even in 1982, available with ABS. And surprise, an airbag. Series production of the 123 coupes ended in August 1985. After 99,884 units came into being. Well-preserved models in mint condition are already traded for aficionado prices today. Speaking of aficionados, one was acting legend Gerd Fürbe.
Wissen Sie, beim Autowaschen, da kommt man seinem Auto doch am nächsten. Da sieht man mal so richtig, was man für ein Prachtstück hat. Übrigens, meine Freunde, die fahren auch solche Waschstücke. Wissen Sie warum? Die brauchen ein sicheres Auto mit viel Fahrkomfort.
In September 1972, Mercedes-Benz debuted a new upper-range generation as successor of Series 108 and 109. It was, for the first time, officially named the Mercedes-Benz S-Class, internally W116. In this first S-Class, a remarkable technical innovation was now serially included. Double wishbone front suspension that tremendously improved performance. The rear wheel suspension had already proved itself in these stroke 8 types. The model range initially included types 280S, 280SE, and 350SE. Half a year later, the type 450SE was released, with a greater cylinder capacity, simultaneously with the 100 millimeter longer 450SEL. After 1973, the lengthened version was additionally available as 350SEL, and a year later as 280SEL. The safety dashboard and the well-proportioned interior was strongly padded. Moreover, flexible switches and levers, along with the inclusion of a four-spoke safety steering wheel with impact improver, provided the highest possible passenger protection. Also, in regard to passive safety, the S-Class exemplified the state of the art. The fuel tank was not at the immediate rear anymore, but above the rear axle, safe from collision. And the most important improvement compared to its predecessor, a safety cage with stiffened top frame structure and high strength roof pillars and door posts. In May 1975, a new S-Class top model was released, the type 450SEL 6.9. With a cubic capacity of nearly 7 liters, the 6.9 was considered a true torque wonder. Its driving performance even outdid some of the super sports cars of its time. The hitherto unused hydropneumatic suspension with level control system offered driving comfort of the highest degree. In a class of their own, the S-Class sedans were bestowed with the newly developed anti-lock brake system ABS. Even when slamming the brakes, ABS assures steering capability. What is today a worldwide standard, even in compact cars, was in 1978 a real sensation. In 1979, Mercedes-Benz issued the follow-ups into the 126 series. Production of the 116s did continue on for a while, though, until September 1980. When the last of the 473,035 units left the Sindelfingen facilities. In 1979, a new generation of the Mercedes-Benz S-Class took over from the model range 116. Initially, it included 7 types. In 1981, a coupe version supplemented the choice. The new S-Class of range 126 symbolized the changing spirit of automobile production and clearly showed that the often baroque body styles of the 70s were finally over. Despite initial criticism, the 126s turned out to be a successful endeavor. Fuel-saving measures were significant in these new upper-range models. This was accomplished by the use of lightweight materials, plus a body that was optimized in the wind tunnel. 2 variants were for sale, the regular saloon and a long version with a lengthened wheelbase of 140 millimeters. The engine selection of the S-Class went from a 2.8-liter six-cylinder carburetor, output 156 horsepower, to a 5-liter V8 light metal engine with fuel injection, boosted to 240 horsepower. In line with the Mercedes-Benz energy concept to reduce fuel consumption and emissions, both V8 engines were respecified in 1981. For the first time, automatic seat adjustment was incorporated into a Mercedes-Benz passenger car. The The plush, spacious interior permitted comfortable travel in all seats. Seat belts were adjustable for all sizes. A new age of passive safety commenced in 1981. The first airbag was fitted into the S-Class. Together with a seatbelt preload device and ABS, they soon were part of the standard series equipment.
Das ist für mich der Gipfel der Sicherheit. Bei einem Frontalaufprall macht es pft, und in 30 Millisekunden bläst es sich auf.
In 1985, Mercedes-Benz introduced a re-engineered type program. Aside from small visual modifications, the engines were the foreground. Type 420 SE replaced the former 380 SE. A V8 204 horsepower engine with catalytic converter was incorporated into the SEC Coupe and the SL Roadster. The most dazzling novelty of the year was undoubtedly the 560 SEL. Its 272 horsepower 8-cylinder made it the strongest of Mercedes-Benz's mass-produced passenger cars. In 1986, a three-way catalytic converter became commonplace. The last units of the 126 S-Class saloons left the Sindelfingen line in autumn 1991. In the company's history to date, this type was the most successful in the upper range. A total of 818,036 cars were manufactured. The 126 series fostered its own coupe variations in September 1981. Types 380 SEC and 500 SEC superseded the old SLC models. The new generation now was based on the S-Class sedans instead of the SL model as before. Only the horizontal radiator grille remained as a visual relic. The elegant and harmonious appearance found instant acclaim. Even today, car aficionados worldwide rank the SEC Coupe among the most beautiful post-war car models. Apart from a few details, the chassis complied with those of the sedans, to which the Coupe also owed its double wishbone axle and the semi-trailing arm rear axle. The front wheels of the SEC coupes were equipped with floating caliper disc brakes for the first time. Also, the floor pan components were basically taken over from the sedans, but shorter by 85 millimeters. Under the hood, V8 engines were quite potent, as had been proven in the sedans and SLC models. In the course of the Mercedes-Benz energy concept, the engines were modified for the reduction of fuel and emissions. Therefore, fuel consumption of the SEC Coupe was considerably less than that of its predecessor. Interior equipment was also modeled on that of the sedans. For fans of technical comforts, an automatic belt handover was installed as a series standard. The body of the SEC Coupe answered to the latest results in safety research. In contrast to the sedans, the B-pillar was missing, which was compensated for by a strengthened roof frame and reinforced A-pillars. The SEC Coupes were first revised 4 years after their debut in 1985. Aside from a discrete facelift, the restructuring of the engines was significant. A 4.2-liter V8 engine with 245 horsepower was added to the agenda. However, the real sensation was the 560 SEC. This top model revved up to 273 horsepower from a 5-liter cubic capacity. From 1986 on, catalytic converters were standard in all Mercedes-Benz petrol engines. The coupe's standard equipment was also upgraded, plus the appearance was slightly altered. Deep drawn aprons improved road holding at high speed. Moreover, the new models received smooth protective strips and new shock absorbers. In September 1987, output increased variations off all V8 engines were introduced. Almost 10 years after their entrance into the market, production of the SEC coupes came to a standstill. A total of 74,060 units testified to their select appeal. In February 1979, Mercedes-Benz dared to tread an unfamiliar terrain. Developed in cooperation with the Austrian Steyr Daimler Puch Corporation since 1973, the G model was possibly the most versatile Mercedes-Benz passenger car ever, but above all, cross-country suitable.
The brake is...
The model choice of the G range originally included four engine and five body variations. Aside from an open car with a short wheelbase, a station wagon and two van versions were available. At the beginning of production, the tried and true petrol and diesel engines from series 123 were used. Over the years, this star-bearing trekking vehicle was modified numerous times, which particularly benefited the engines. In September 1989, a new chapter in the story of the G model was opened with a substantially improved series, internally called 463. This new off-road vehicle impressed many with its modern design and comparably comfortable interior. Technical changes were also noteworthy, such as four-wheel drive, series differential locks, and anti-lock brake systems. Apart from the modified engines of series 460, two new six-cylinder motors powered the vehicles, a diesel and a gasoline, both with a 3-liter cubic capacity. 1992 saw the market debut of the 136 horsepower 350 GD turbo. On the other end of the spectrum ranked the 240 horsepower type 500 GE V8. Type designations were adapted in 1993. The G was put in front of the three-figure number.
The brake is...
Another new addition was the type G320, generating 210 horsepower. In 1996, the G300 turbo diesel superseded the G350 turbo diesel. In contrast to its predecessor, the new diesel model was issued with a four-valve turbo engine and intercooling. 1997 brought some more substantial revamping. The new cabriolet was provided with an electro-hydraulic operating soft top. The G320 was bestowed with a newly developed V6 engine. And all models from range 463 were supplied with rear disc brakes. In April 1998, the new top model had its premiere, the G500, with a 300 horsepower V8 engine. Amongst the standard specials were air conditioning and leather upholstery. A simplified version, internally W461, entered the market in 1992. It was essentially derived from the original G model of range 460 and was planned for commercial and public service. The new range also counted the still available 230 GD. optional bodies were station wagon and van on a longer wheelbase.
The brake is...
In December 2000, the G-Class was overhauled once again. This time, the diesel motors were the beneficiaries and were adapted to the common rail principle. The youngest generation offered two more models, the G320 with a 215 horsepower V6 engine and a V8 gasoline G500 topping 296 horsepower. A five-gear automatic transmission with a modern Tiptronic gear shift mechanism is standard in all variants. The interior was generously upscaled too. A cabrio with electric folding top and station wagons with two or four doors are also obtainable. The G designated cross country, being a genuine classic, secured a fixed place in the type program. Thus, production also continued after the successful introduction of the M-Class. In 2004, Mercedes-Benz celebrated the 25th anniversary of the G-Class. In September 2004, the new and eagerly awaited A-Class version, internally W169, was released. Already 10 weeks before the sales start, 50,000 orders were out. Moreover, the new series includes two body versions. The versatile little one is from now on available with five or three doors. Newly fashioned headlights, a charismatic radiator grille, and muscular fenders determine the new look. Literally grown up are the outside measures. The former Baby Benz has grown 232 millimeters in length and 45 millimeters in width. For more pleasurable performance comfort, a newly devised parabolic rear axle is now standard issue along with electromechanical steering. Premiered is also a self-selecting shock absorber system, which automatically adapts itself to the current driving condition. More torque, more fun, higher performance, and less fuel consumption. The aims in engine design. Compared to its predecessor, the output of both gasoline and diesel engines in the new A-Class rose 38%. With a 46% torque increase. The interior equipment of the second generation seems altogether more upscale. Pleasant materials surround a functional cockpit. An obvious enhancement in legroom, plus larger seats, make the new A-Class more travel suitable. A stowable back seat ensures the storage room flexibility. An integral part of the safety package is still the patented sandwich concept. According to it, the passengers sit above the critical impact zone. Engine and gear unit are tilted, and in case of a frontal impact, glide downwards. Additional head and chest protection is offered by serially included side airbags. Into the second generation, the A-Class has remained true to its reputation as a technological trendsetter. Groundbreaking innovations celebrate their premiere, for which over 200 patents were registered. With types 190 and 190E, Mercedes sent the first generation of compact sedans into series production in 1982. Right from the start, the little baby Benz was a sales hit. The 201 series has quickly become a constant part of the sales program, and besides, is among the most successful Mercedes-Benz passenger car series of all. The newly configured rear axle alignment of the W201 has positive effects to the overall driving experience. Consistent weight reduction and an aerodynamically optimized body also add to the already reduced fuel consumption. But considered to be the most spectacular of all technical novelties is the multi-link rear suspension. Each rear wheel is guided by 5 independent steering arms. This way, undesired movements are avoided. The brake is an exception. As the first Mercedes-Benz passenger car since 1968, the compact car is equipped with a conventional handbrake. The usual version in the footwell must make way. Both models are powered by a 2-liter 4-cylinder engine. The newly engineered fuel injection of the 190E boosts a handsome 122 horsepower. The 4-cylinder engine of the parallel introduced 190D, generating 72 horsepower, is the forerunner of a new generation of high-performance diesel engines. Despite its compact outer appearance, the 190's interior is spacious and comfortable, suitable for long journeys. The baby Benz Mercedes family pedigree is evident in the sweeping inner design and the selection of materials. In terms of safety, the compact sedan is equal to the S-Class, despite lesser deformation paths. This is secured by the fork structure of the front section. Furthermore, the W201 fulfills the criteria for asymmetrical frontal impact. The 201 series is cherished and pampered like hardly any other. First, in 1983, 3 new models supplemented the type program. The top model of the range was the 190E 2.316, generating 185 horsepower and carrying the characteristic wing spoiler on the rear trunk lid. It could already boast of racing success long before its official premiere.
22 Uhr der Start. Noch liegt das Ziel 9 Nächte und 8 Tage weit entfernt. Immer mit Höchstgeschwindigkeit rund die Uhr und ohne Pannen geht es über 25.000 Kilometer, 25.000 Meilen und über 50.000 Kilometer. Das Ergebnis dieser strapaziösen Langstreckenfahrt: 3 neue Weltrekorde über Distanzen von 25.000 Kilometer, 25.000 Meilen und 50.000 Kilometer. Dazu 12 internationale Klassenrekorde. Außerdem der 13., 14. und 15. Weltrekord für Mercedes-Benz-Fahrzeuge seit 1976.
The next sensation followed only 2 years later. The 190E 2.6 with a sumptuous 2.6-liter engine. The 190D 2.5 turbo rounded off the model range in 1987. Its 5-cylinder turbo diesel churned out 122 horsepower. In 1988, the range was thoroughly redone again, and the 190E 2.516 was introduced. The update served as a technical base for the race touring cars of Group A that were entered into the German Touring Car Championship. In 1989, the Type 190E 2.516 Evolution served as a homologation special for racing. Exactly 502 units were built, furnished in blue-black metallic, and delivered to choice customers. The modified versions from 1990 are recognizable by their lateral protection strips. Front and rear aprons are lowered and have voluminous bumpers attached to them. Additionally, a new high-end vehicle joins the range, Type 190E 2.516 Evolution 2. Just like its predecessor, dubbed Evo 1, 505 units of the Evo 2 were built. Its aggressive appearance with big front spoilers, widened fenders, and giant rear spoilers visually alludes to its high potency of 234 horsepower. A last model makeover in 1991 added the ABS to the compact class's standard equipment. These latest model variants can be identified by outer mirror casings lacquered in the car's color. In 1993, the Mercedes plant in Sindelfingen shut down production. A total of 1,879,629 units of the popular 190 had left the assembly line. In 1993, the second generation of the compact class was launched. The 202 series replaces the 190, affectionately known as Baby Benz. Simultaneously, a new range name was introduced. Mercedes-Benz traced the success of the first C-Class back to the newly adopted philosophy, price and value, that extols the use of high-quality materials and offers generous standard equipment. Amongst the advantages of the new compact Mercedes are an evidently larger interior with almost unchanged outside measurements. Even the basic range, the classic line, provides a driver airbag, side impact protection, ABS, servo steering, five-gear transmission, and central locking. The type program of the C-Class includes seven different motor setups. The gasoline engines usually come with four valve engines, which were tested and proven in the 124 series. A 1.8-liter engine is a novelty in the current range. A world premiere is celebrated with the two 4-valve diesel engines, which, like all diesel models, come with exhaust gas recirculation and oxidizing catalyst. Due to a new concept, all C-Class types are offered in various design and equipment lines. Apart from the classic version, the choice includes the variants Esprit, Elegance, and Sport. The sum of Mercedes-Benz's entire 50 years of safety research also finds its expression in the C-Class. Fourth generation ABS, driver and front passenger airbags, and a new safety steering column are part of the compact's safety package. It underwent the first small makeover in 1995. In the context of the IAA, the modified models debuted with updated equipment lines and two new model variations. Until 1997, about a million units left the line. In response to this, the C-Class presented itself with a new look and a technical update. Two newly engineered V6 engines were paramount in the second revamping. The series standard was also enhanced. Lateral airbags in the front doors, modified preload devices in the front, and the electronical braking assistant, to name the most important. Arguably, the most stunning new introduction of the year was Type 220 CDI, which marked the beginning of the common rail diesel engine era, delivering 125 horsepower and a 300 newton meter torque. While conventional systems produce the pressure for every injection anew, CDI engines work with a joint connection that distributes the fuel under a constant high pressure to the magnetic valves of the injectors. In 1998, the 220 CDI was complemented by a variant with slightly reduced performance. The 200 CDI succeeded the C220 diesel with its naturally aspired pre-chamber engine. The C-Class of Series 202 proved to be a trendsetter for future development in many areas of its class. And besides, it introduced the diversified equipment and design lines, which up to today help create each Mercedes-Benz with an individual note. With the launch of the C-Class T models of Series 202, Mercedes-Benz first pushed into the compact station wagon market in 1996 and immediately set the trend. All types of the first model generation were produced with a new 5-gear standard transmission, or with the optional 5-gear automatic transmission with converter, lock-up clutch, and power steering. Initially, the model range included 3 gasoline and 2 diesel engines, the 2.2-liter diesel, the 2.5-liter turbo diesel, plus the 1.8, 2, and 2.3-liter 4-cylinder gasoline engines. All 3 auto motors are partially modified variants of their sedan counterparts. If the storage space of the C-Class station wagons is used to its full extent, it can take up to 1,510 liters. Just like the sedan, the T models are assigned to the equipment lines: Classic, Elegance, Esprit, and Sport. The T model of the C-Class not only offers more space and versatility, but also raises the benchmark in passive safety, even surpassing that of the sedan in case of rear impact. In 1997, both sedans and T models presented themselves in a slightly modified form. The upgrade revolved around 2 newly developed V6 engines with 2.4 and 2.8 liters cubic capacities. Since June 1997, the T model has also been available with a C230 compressor. The C220 CDI causes a stir at the other end of the performance scale. Like the sedan before it, the T model debuted the modern diesel technology of the common rail principle. The C-Class T models were produced in the Bremen plant, where the multi-purpose car left the assembly line together with the hatchback variant until 2001. In March 2000, the new Mercedes-Benz C-Class celebrated its world premiere. After approximately 5 years in development, an investment of 1.36 billion euros. The declared aim, continuing the predecessor's resounding success. With a new face and dynamic driving characteristics, the compact is supposed to attract a younger audience. The new C-Class sedans, now for the first time, have a technical makeup that hitherto had been reserved for the upper range. The front end is enhanced with crash boxes made of high-strength steel. After an accident, they can be replaced easily and with low costs. The chassis is characterized by a newly developed A-arm front axle. Larger disc brakes with improved cooling airflow guarantee the best possible braking comfort. The power spectrum reaches from the 129 horsepower C180 to the 354 horsepower C32 AMG, which was introduced in 2001. Among the self-injectors, the choice includes the C200 CDI, the C220 CDI, and the C270 CDI. The top diesel variant since 2002 has been the C30 CDI AMG. The three equipment lines in the new C-Class are named Classic, Elegance, and Avant-Garde. Striking features include the multi-purpose steering wheel, the functional cockpit, and the high-quality treatment of the interior. The series safety equipment meets the standards of the top models. Window bags and adaptive airbags for driver and front passenger ensure the best possible protection. In 2004, the model was updated with the slogan, Direct Control. Under this premise, suspension, chassis, six-gear transmission, and steering are more directly arranged.
Kann ich fahren? Dafür bist du zu alt.
The C-Class combines the virtues of a Mercedes-Benz passenger car, dynamic handling, extraordinary comfort, and the highest measure of safety. After the introduction of the new C-Class, the eagerly awaited T model of the 203 series was released in March 2001. Its dynamic appearance exhibits a high degree of functionality. The designer's concept obviously underlines the lifestyle character of this elegantly proportioned station wagon. Its close relation to the C-Class sedan is particularly revealed in the technical makeup. The chassis is characterized by a newly developed A-arm front axle. Large disc brakes with improved cooling airflow guarantee the best possible braking. At the beginning of production, the type program included 7 different motor options, 4 gasoline and 3 diesel. After an upgrade of the C-Class in 2004, the C200 CGI became the special vehicle of the range. It combines direct gasoline injection with a charge compressor, hence the abbreviation CGI for stratified charged gasoline injection. The type program was crowned by 2 top models from AMG. The 367 horsepower 5.5-liter V8 engine of the C55 AMG catapults this sporty station wagon from 0 to 100 kilometers per hour in only 5.4 seconds. At 231 horsepower, the diesel version C30 CDI AMG was not bad either. Apart from high interior comfort, the C-Class station wagon boasts even more storage capacity. The load compartment holds up to 1,354 liters. Several holding and placement devices, plus the stowable seats, offer manifold use options. Sedans like the T models of the 203 series are role models in safety. That is impressively documented with crash tests of the European NCAP standard. The C-Class succeeds with 5 stars, the highest rating in this test procedure. With its sleek shape, broad spectrum of equipment, and power options, the T model of the C-Class quickly became the market leader in the segment of lifestyle station wagons, and that for a good reason. The Mercedes-Benz Sport Coupe, formerly assigned to the C-Class, but really quite an independent variant. The sporty compact two-door has been on the market since the end of 2000. It is distinguished by a typical finned radiator grille with a Mercedes star in the central position. The unusual outline both inspires and polarizes. The unusual rear design with integrated spoilers and a darkened blind between the rear lights also serve a function. The high spoiler edge provides exemplary aerodynamic lifting effect and therefore reduces fuel consumption. The coupe is powered by the latest four-cylinder engines. The C230 mobilizes an impressive 197 horsepower. And turns from 0 to 100 kilometers per hour in only 8 seconds. Also available, a 163 horsepower 2-liter engine with mechanical charger, a 4-cylinder with 129 horsepower, plus a 2.2-liter CDI engine. At the top of the line, the 254 horsepower C32 AMG Sport Coupe stands with the AMG diesel variation, which produces 540 newton-meter torque. Sporty elegance determines the interior. A must for sun worshippers, the panorama sunroof in glass design. In the course of the C-Class upgrade in 2004, the two-door coupe was given a sporty trim. The interior now presents itself with a newly designed dashboard and a multifunction steering wheel. A crisp transmission and a more taut chassis deliver a dynamic performance. The sport coupe of the C-Class combines all attributes of a compact limousine with the styling of a coupe, and hence is a particular favorite of the younger target group. In 1997, Mercedes-Benz launched a new generation of its legendary coupes, the CLK. Just 1 year later, the CLK Cabriolet was issued. The design of Series 208, incidentally, derives from a coupe survey in 1993. It gives a completely new interpretation of Mercedes' classical face. Four elliptical headlights, more shapely fenders, and a slim hood features the new look. Technically, both coupes and cabriolet benefit from a whole new set of novelties. Among them, the driver authorization system, L-Code, and the braking assistance system, BAS. It automatically recognizes emergency situations and therefore can build up the maximum brake power support much quicker than before. The coupes and cabriolets of the CLK class also share engine options. A real novelty is the V6 engine of the CLK 320, putting out 218 horsepower. The engines of both the CLK 200 and the CLK 230 compressor are based on the already proven engines from the C and E class. In January 1998, a newcomer adds to the range. The new top model CLK 430 mobilizes a stunning 279 horsepower. The interior gains the most from the lavish standard equipment of the CLK class. The easy entry system facilitates entry and exit for rear passengers. Stowable seats allow for more storage space in the trunk. The cabriolet is also made to be a four-seater. Despite its intricate construction, the half-automatic convertible top is easy to operate and disappears in the trunk, thus saving space. The CLK class fulfills all requirements for passive safety. Incidentally, a standard in all of Mercedes-Benz automobiles. the front structure of the CLK is constructed to absorb and dispel another car's impact energy in a collision. In the cabriolets, reinforced A-pillars and high-strength windshield frames ensure the survival space of the passengers. The rollover protection feature, proven in other ranges, is also installed here. With the threat of rolling over, it unfolds automatically within split seconds. Since August 1999, a new coupe top lines the modified CLK class. By the way, chassis and engine technology of the CLK 55 AMG were used in the same year in the safety car of the Formula One. On the outside, the upgraded CLK are first of all recognizable by their lacquered sill panel and side mirror integrated indicators. About half a year later, the CLK 200 was released as a 163 horsepower compressor. And another few weeks later, the CLK 430 was finally available as a cabriolet. In 2002, Mercedes-Benz continued the success formula of the CLK class with the Series 209. The new range's self-confident character is visually recognizable by its typical radiator grille and the newly interpreted 4-eye face. At the time of market entry, 7 variably motorized models with 3 transmission options were offered. The 8-cylinder CLK 500 and CLK 55 AMG are the leaders of the range. In 2004, the AMG Sport Car Specialist introduced a limited special edition of 100 vehicles. Racing legend Klaus Ludwig is one of the test drivers who checked the roadworthiness of the racing sports car.
Das Auto ist der Bruder des legendären DTM CLK. Dieses Fahrzeug hat 582 PS bei 800 Newtonmeter Drehmoment, da kann natürlich der Rennwagen aus der DTM nicht mithalten.
This collector's car can only be enjoyed by its well-heeled owners. The sports cannon costing an exorbitant 235,000 euros is already sold out. Without a doubt, the CLK class is one of the most beautiful results of the Mercedes-Benz product offensive. The CLK pioneers new territory and is rewarded by broad acceptance. In 1997, Mercedes-Benz dared to enter unknown terrain. The M-Class is the first German model to debut in the new class of sport utility vehicles. It has been imitated numerous times since. This recreational vehicle with luxurious tendencies is produced in purpose-built facilities in Tuscaloosa, Alabama. A second production plant was opened in Graz in 1999. The series, internally called W163, incorporates intelligent four-wheel drive and an electronically operated five-gear automatic transmission. A specially designed independent wheel suspension at the front and rear axles aids optimal driving stability. Another novelty, the electronic traction support system, ETS. It improves the maneuverability of the vehicle in rough off-road situations. The anti-lock brake system, ABS, is also modified for cross-country use. The ML320 with a 3.2-liter engine was first introduced in Canada and the United States. The ML230 with a 2.3-liter engine is reserved for the European market. Incidentally, this car possesses a great expanse of space. seat backs and seats are stowable and make a multi-purpose layout possible. Mercedes-Benz specifications also include all safety-relevant equipment details. The M-Class is the first cross-country vehicle with side bags in the doors. An improved chassis frame is supposed to preserve the passenger compartment in case of an impact. Additionally, the car is designed for partner protection. The front structure and a lowered frame compensate the impact energy of the opposing vehicle. In 1998, the new Vanguard model of the range was introduced, the ML430, carrying a 4.3-liter V8 engine running at 272 horsepower. In Germany, it has been available since 1999. At that time, the 100,000th M-Class unit had already been produced, and Mercedes-Benz presents the ML270 CDI principally for the European market. 2001 saw the considerable improvement of the M-Class. The new line is also visually different from its predecessors, with redesigned shock absorbers, headlights with a transparent glass look, and outside mirrors with integrated indicators. There is also news in the model range. The ML430 has been replaced by the ML500. Putting out 292 horsepower with its V8 engine. At the time of its market entry, the new type ML400 CDI was the most powerful self-injection car in the world. However, the new top model is the ML55 AMG. Its high power engine makes 347 horsepower and shoots from 0 to 100 in only 6.8 seconds. In August 2002, the ML350 replaced the ML320. The powerful character of the M-Class is manifested in its 245 newton meter torque. By the way, even before their official premiere, the M-Class had a career in Hollywood. In Jurassic Park 2, The Lost World, the Mercedes cross-country car leaves the aggressive dinosaurs behind.